grace, O Lord, to speak in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here with you together with my wife, Ivy, at Trinity Church Columbus, and to share in your worship this morning. Irene and I are so grateful to your fine rector for his welcome and his care for us. We love coming to the States. We've been to the States many, many times, and over the years we've gathered some wonderful friends, and I'm sure we're adding to the number this weekend. As a former Archbishop of Canterbury, I'm well aware of the way in which your national church, the Episcopal Church of the United States, has made an enormous contribution to the Anglican communion, serving the very poor. So on behalf of them, thank you for all you do. Last week, my wife and I had, no, I should say 2 weeks ago, my wife and I had a wonderful four-day stay in Seville, in southern Spain. And if you've been there, you know that the vast cathedral dominates the city, and without any doubt is one of the most outrageous, over-the-top, most beautiful buildings and cathedrals in the world. It boasts to be the largest Gothic cathedral, and it hosts the funeral place, it hosts the burial place of Christopher Columbus. So it's got a link with you. And even though we know that Columbus never came here, but who cares about that? The cathedral was built on the site of a huge mosque. And the Christians, as they took over, reoccupied southern Spain, decided to build a magnificent cathedral on the very spot. And even more extravagant than the mosque. And so in 1403, the chapter of the cathedral decided to go ahead. And this is the record. This is what we find in their record. Let us build a church so beautiful and so grand that those who come later and see it finished will think that we are mad. And I love that description. And so construction began, and wait for it, Tim. The clergy promised to give half their stipend to the finishing of the work. The bad news of the clergy, it took 100 years to finish. But my imagination was gripped by the phrase, let us build a church so beautiful and so grand that those who see it finished will think that we are mad. Now perhaps none of us are in danger of confusing our faith or our love of this fine church as being a sign of madness. But is there not a touch of it when something of importance comes into our lives? The epistle from Philippians 3 is an astonishing testimony of Paul's attitude to the Christian faith. He describes his glittering career, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a scholar, a successful preacher, a teacher. And then he says, I count all this as garbage, as useless. And he adds this breathtaking statement, one thing I do, forgetting all that is behind me, I strain towards what is ahead, I press on towards that goal to win the prize to which God has called me heavenward. This great message is not only astonishing, we might call it slightly mad, slightly dotted. Who would want to give up everything like that for the gospel? Imagine a person as rich as Bill Gates giving his entire wealth away. Or the Queen of England going into social housing. Now that's something for everybody. I mean, we might well term these actions crazy, dotty. Who would want to do it? Now, I want to advance this argument this morning, that the problem with Christians in my country and your country and other parts of the world is that we're not mad enough. We're not mad enough. Because we're safe. We're unpersecuted. We are protected. Our Christian faith is costless, riskless, and as a consequence, less than exciting. And Paul's testimony to his sacrifice sounds like madness in our ears. But you will remember that in 1 Corinthians, he does talk about the foolishness of God that's wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God stronger than man's strength. Yet, he's hinting there about the madness of God. And our cruel and undemanding faith contrasts very sharply at the present moment with the suffering of Christians in Iraq at the present time, as the ancient church of the Chaldeans is driven from its native land by the dreadful Islamic State, who, as you know, in the last day or so, have beheaded yet another person. For many centuries, this noble church of the Chaldeans has survived only by its members willing to make enormous sacrifices, by being dimly Christians, in other words, by people paying a tax, being regarded as second class. I mentioned on Friday that my friend Canon Andrew White, known as the Vicar of Baghdad, he does a wonderful work in Baghdad. It's the largest Christian church in the Middle East. And he wrote recently, I'm almost in tears, because I've just had someone in my room whose little child was cut in half. I baptized his child in my church in Baghdad. This little boy, they named him after me. He was Andrew. How could such a barbaric act be owned by any religion? And yet, isn't there something so wonderfully courageous in the faith of people who will never change their faith whatever is called upon them, whatever the cost? Yes, it's madness in the eye of the indifferent, but it's in the nature of a genuine faith to exhibit the exuberance of living with Jesus Christ. I know that some of you here have had that kind of experience. In the moments of suffering, the loss of a loved one, you've known something of what it is to make those big questions and wonder, and yet you've stood firm. And the same could be said of someone, one of my heroes, the Scottish missionary David Livingstone, who trained as a doctor, wanted to be a doctor, and then decided halfway through his training that God was calling him to the darkness of Africa. He wanted to serve Africa. In the eyes of his contemporaries, it was madness. Why throw your life away? Conventional medicine was safe, secure, offered a great career. He wasn't interested in a great career. He wanted to serve Jesus Christ. He died on May the 1st, 1873, from malaria and internal bleeding caused by dysentery. He died on his knees in prayer. And Britain requested his body. We want him back with us. And the tribe that he was, and he died on, they said no. And then they relented. And they placed on his body a message. They cut out his heart. And he said, you can have his body, but his heart belongs here in Africa. The flowering of Christianity in Africa owes so much to the suffering and sacrifice of people like David Livingstone, who rests in Westminster Abbey, as you know. Now, our tradition, the Episcopal Anglican tradition, has often been described as having a casual or even a light-hearted attitude towards its faith. We don't have a realistic attitude, it is being claimed by some, towards discipleship. When Bobby Jindal, governor of Louisiana and former Hindu, became a Christian, he chose to become a Roman Catholic. And he justified his choice by saying this: if I wanted the aesthetics without the inconvenient morality, I could have become an Episcopalian. Now, you know, that is an outrageous statement. I do hope the Episcopalians of Louisiana objected to it, because we as Anglicans, we know we're the kind of tradition that struggles with questions. We're prepared to stay with them. But the idea that we stand for a kind of mild holiday, vacation Christianity, is of course total nonsense. Jeremy Paxman, who's a famous newsreader and a media person in the UK, once said, "The Church of England is that kind of church that believes there's no issue that couldn't be eventually settled over a cup of tea in the vicarage." I've got to answer that by saying there's nothing wrong about that. If you believe that disputes can be settled in a civilized and rational conversation, then do let's try it. Robert Rumsey, my great predecessor, once agreed with that kind of idea by talking about Anglican commitment as passionate coolness. Passionate coolness. And it's a wonderful idea and phrase, but it was greatly misunderstood at the time because it suggested that it means you're not serious enough. Although I would argue that that's a wonderful attitude to have. So by implication, Anglicanism, Episcopalian, is seen very often as a cool, undemanding form of faith that anybody could embrace, harmless, therefore costless. I heard this joke recently. It was Friday afternoon in heaven, and there were queues of people waiting to get in. The angels guarding the pearly gates began to panic. They flew off to see Jesus and asked for help. And he said, "Don't worry, I'll take the Friday afternoon shift for you." And they said, "Well, what are you going to do?" He said, "I will simply ask them one question. And the question is one I asked my disciples: who do you say that I am?" And so the first person that came along was a Methodist minister. And Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" And the minister hesitated and then said, "Well, at the Methodist conference last year," and Jesus interrupts and said, "I'm sorry, but I asked your opinion. I didn't ask for your denominational idea. Would you mind going to the back of the queue?" And the next person who stepped forward was a Roman Catholic priest. And Jesus posed the same question, to which the priest said, "Well, the Holy Father said," and Jesus interrupted and said, "I'm well aware of the Holy Father's view, but I ask for your opinion. Go to the back of the queue." And thirdly, a Baptist minister came along, and his response was emphatic. "The Bible says," Jesus then interrupted and said, "I want to know what you believe. I'm well aware of what the Bible says." Finally, as you would guess, an Anglican, Episcopal priest, approaches. And Jesus regards the man rather quizzically, skeptically, but puts the same question to him nevertheless. And the Anglican replies categorically, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus is slightly taken aback by that answer, and then he's about to say, "Go into heaven," when the minister says, "But then again, on the other hand..." Now, it makes actually a very interesting point. It tends to support the idea that Anglicanism is slightly agnostic, cool in its attitude towards truth. But I want to say we embrace strong truths. We are prepared to face challenges. And let me add this: to be a good Anglican, a good Episcopalian, is demanding business. So here we are at the beginning of October, with a full church year ahead of us. challenges, many opportunities, many possibilities. This great church, and it is such a beautiful church, under your clergy, must face new challenges, new opportunities, new costs have to face. And it's not merely about money, or that's a very important element in it, because stewardship includes that. But it's more to do with going deeper into our faith. By being prepared to wrestle with hard questions, by a closer walk with our Lord, spending that extra time day by day in prayer, in your commitment to what is called from you. And our Lord confronts each one of us and seeks from us a more determined attitude to serve and a greater desire to make him known. I want to encourage you. Let there be that touch of madness in your giving, your response to the Lord. Let there be that exuberance that comes from knowing that we serve a Lord whose love endures forever, and that touch of recklessness that says with St. Paul, I press on. I will press on, leaving that that is behind, press on toward that goal which I know is mine in Christ Jesus. There's one particular hymn I love in your hymnody. It's one we don't often sing in the United Kingdom, but when I come here, I always look for it. It's one I think you know well, and it sums up the aspiration of each one of us this morning. And the last verse of this great hymn says, they live not only in ages past, there are hundreds of thousands still. The world is bright with the joyous saints who love to do Jesus' will. You can meet them in school, on the street, in the store, in church by the sea, in the house next door. They are saints of God, whether rich or poor. And I